of our graduate courses spent long period in his laboratory at the University of California. We can divide the electrophysiology times in three parts. The first part before the work of Erwin Meher and Bernd Sackmann, who discovered or who developed the patch clamp techniques. And then before and after Ariel Escobar developed approaches for the recording of ionic current in cardiomyocytes in the whole heart. This is a short version of him, his important work in the electrophysiology. Welcome, Ariel, and I hope to meet you here in our
group. Me too. I don't know when that will happen, but as soon as I will get the shots, I will start traveling again. Thanks a lot for your kind introduction. Today I will speak about the molecular basis of the development of some arrhythmias in the ventricle. Yeah, these arrhythmias are called T-wave alternances, and this is a very old story. In the 19th century, some physicians noticed that when the heart was beating strong,
Can I have to mute the microphone?
Can I ask to mute the microphone because it's very... I muted the microphone
that was open on.
Okay. So as I told you, this is a very old story. The physicians found that when the heart has a strong beat and a weak beat mechanically, this has a very bad prognosis, and they call this pulsus alternans. It was not until Eindhoven developed the electrocardiogram that people were able to see these alternances in the electrical activity of the heart. Basically, alternances in the T wave that defines the repolarization of the action potential in the heart. So let's see what happened with electrical activity of the heart during tachycardia. So we'll measure the a transmural electrocardiogram. So we have an electrode inside the ventricle and an electrode outside the ventricle. So the relationship between the action potentials and the electrocardiogram is shown here. The first layer that is depolarized is the endocardium, and the first layer that repolarizes is the epicardium. The epicardial action potential is shorter than the endocardial action potential, and if we measure the difference between the endocardium and epicardium, we'll have a signal like this, where the QRS represents the difference in the depolarization of the action potential between endocardium and epicardium, and the T-wave represents the repolarization, the difference in the repolarization between endocardium and epicardium. So what happened to the heart when we paced the different heart rates? This heart at 31, I decided to choose this temperature to make it more evident, So you can see a QRS, a T-wave, a QRS, a T-wave. If we increase the heart rate to 6 hertz, we'll have QRS T wave. But if we increase the heart rate to 8 hertz, you can see that we have a QRS, a big T wave, QRS not T wave, QRS a big T wave, and QRS no T wave. Yeah, when we have no T wave, this indicates that the repolarization on the endocardium of the endocardium and the epicardium occurs at the same time. If we increase the heart rate to the natural heart rate of a mouse, you will see that we have a positive T wave, a negative T wave, a positive T wave, and a negative T wave. And this difference in the T wave is related to the duration of the action potential, both in the epicardium and endocardium, and I will spend more time on that. So tachycardia-induced T-wave alternances in the electrocardiogram. Yeah? Why alternances induce arrhythmias? So normally, we have a depolarization that goes from endocardium to epicardium, and a repolarization that goes from epicardium to endocardium. When we have alternances, we have a depolarization going from endocardium to epicardium, But if the action potential in the endocardium becomes shorter, yeah, in one place, the repolarization can occur from endocardium to epicardium instead of having one from epicardium to endocardium. The duration of the action potential can reverse the T wave of the electrocardiogram. Let me see if I can do this. No. So if we look, yeah, the place we have a repolarization from the endocardium to the epicardium, this can produce an endo-EP reentry, and this endo-EP reentry can induce an arrhythmia. So this is the basic scheme of a ventricular action potential. The ventricular action potentials, they have T-tubes, yeah? We have calcium channels both in the surface membrane and the T-tubes, and also sodium channels in the surface membrane and the T-tube. If we have an action potential, the action potential will propagate through the T-tube, yeah? They will increase the open probability of calcium channels, yeah? As we have a driving force, we have an influx of calcium. Calcium will produce an increase in the concentration in this space that is called the dyadic space. Increasing calcium will produce binding to the ryanodine receptor. The ryanodine receptor is a calcium release channel that is triggered by calcium, yeah? They have 4 binding sites in the cytosol. So we have 4 calcium bound to the ryanodine receptor, will have a big increase in the open ability of the channel. Then we'll have a massive release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Calcium will bind to troponin C and will induce contraction. And then calcium can be reuptaken to the sarcoplasmic reticulum through this calcium ATPase, CRK2A, yeah? That is regulated by this other protein, it's called phospholamban, yeah? Calcium is not free inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. There is a protein called calsequestrin that plays a dual role, calcium buffering, and we'll see that calsequestrin can also luminally regulate the open probability of the ryanodine receptor. Finally, calcium can be extruded from the cell through this protein called the sodium calcium exchanger that produces the influx of 3 sodiums and an influx of 1 calcium. So in which place of the ventricular wall alternances start? Yeah, I will use this approach along the talk a lot. Yeah, we have a heart, we can perfuse the heart with dyes, calcium dyes, yeah, in the cytosol, calcium dyes in the lumen of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and dyes for measuring the membrane potential. We can illuminate the heart through a multimode fiber optic, yeah? The molecules will be excited, and when they relax, we will be able to see fluorescence. In this case, we have a dual measurement, yeah? So we can place a balloon inside the left ventricle. So the balloon is for measure the developed pressure in the left ventricle, yeah? So we can measure simultaneously free calcium concentration in the epicardium and the pressure in the ventricle, yeah? If we go to 2 hertz, yeah, you can see that we have epicardial calcium transients, that they are faster than the pressure. But if we increase the heart rate, this low temperature, yeah, if we increase the heart rate, we'll see that the calcium have no change, but the pressure has a big change. The pressure is alternating, yeah? We have this pulsus alternans. We have a big pressure, small pressure, big pressure. So this indicates that there must be some region inside the ventricular wall that is alternating. So if we further increase the heart rate to 4 Hz, you can also see that we start seeing alternations in the calcium, but the alternations in the pressure, they are much larger. So this means that alternances, they don't start in the epicardium. There must be another layer inside the ventricular wall that is alternating at lower frequencies. So in which place of the ventricle, of the ventricular wall, calcium alternances begin? So what we'll do is to measure simultaneously the endocardial calcium transients, the epicardial calcium transients. We'll measure the action potential with a microelectrode, and we'll measure the EKG, yeah, the transmural EKG. So if we measure simultaneously endocardium and epicardium, what we'll see is that the alternances in the endocardium, that they are the black ones, yeah, they are larger than the alternances in the epicardium. So the endocardium alternates more than the epicardium, and we'll see which are the molecular bases of this. Yeah. If we look at the electrical recordings, yeah, we'll see that the EKG represents, it shows a T wave, an inverted T wave, and a T wave, yeah? So there is a correlation between the alternating behavior of the calcium in the endocardium, yeah, and the alternating behavior in the electrocardiogram, yeah? So alternances start in the endocardium. Yeah. How calcium alternances are transduced in action potential duration alternances, which is the mechanism. So here we have a scheme, L-type calcium channel, ion receptor, sodium calcium exchanger. Yeah. If we have calcium transients, the black are control. Yeah. And the red one is when we block calcium release from the SAR using ryanodine. Yeah. That binds to the ion receptor, and tapsigargine that will block the pump, yeah? Yeah, we'll have a smaller amplitude of the calcium transient. And if we look at the action potential, we can see that if we have a smaller amplitude in the calcium transient, the action potential repolarizes much faster. So which is the mechanism? So there are several possible mechanisms. In the mouse, the most important one is the sodium calcium exchanger. So we decide to block the sodium calcium exchanger. So if we block the sodium calcium exchanger, you can see that we have an increase in the amplitude of the calcium transient. This is because calcium cannot be extruded from the cell and will accumulate inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So when we look at the action potential, when the sodium calcium exchanger is blocked, we can see that the repolarization is also faster. So there is a relationship between the change in free calcium concentration in the cytosol and the duration of the action potential, and this mediated by the activation of the sodium calcium exchanger. So calcium release from the sarcoplasmic reticulum defines the action potential repolarization by activating the sodium calcium exchanger. So in which place of the ventricular wall electrical alternances begin? So now we will measure action potentials optically, endocardium and epicardium. Yeah, this is a electrical recording. The blue are the EKGs, and the green are the microelectrode recordings. Yeah, and when we look at the duration of the action potential, we can see the endocardium depolarized before than the epicardium. The phase one in the endocardium is lower than the epicardium because we have less Kb4.2, Kb4.3. Yeah, and if we increase the heart rate, you can see that the endocardial action potential becomes shorter, and then they become longer, yeah? So the T-wave alternances are induced by action potential duration alternance in the endocardium. The endocardium get a long action potential, a short action potential, a long action potential, and a short action potential. Why the calcium alternances start in the endocardium? So if we look at the ventricular wall, we have the epicardium and endocardium. So what we did, we got slices, like brain slices, yeah? And we analyzed using qPCR or RT-PCR, the the expression of the messenger, yeah? So, and we found this, yeah? We have much less pump in the endocardium, yeah? We have the same amount of phospholamban in the endocardium, so the fractions of the pump inhibited by phospholamban, they're larger, yeah? And this decrease in the amplitude in the expression of SERCA2, yeah, we think is involved in the development of the alternances, and my talk will be centered on this issue. Yeah, calcium alternases heavily depends on the heart rate and the temperature. Yeah, so these are 20 Celsius. We can see that we have calcium transients. Yeah, if we increase the heart rate to 8 hertz, yeah, you can see big alternances in the amplitude of the transients, a big transient, small transient, big transient, small transient. If we increase the temperature to 33, you can see that the relaxation of the calcium transient is much faster. And if we increase this to 8 hertz, the alternances disappear, yeah? So alternances heavily depends on the heart rate, yeah? And also heavily depends on the temperature, yeah? So calcium alternances strongly depends on the temperature. So which is our hypothesis about the alternance generation? Yeah, the first one is related to the recovery from inactivation of the renin receptor. Yeah, this is a cycle. Yeah, if the renin receptor cannot recover from inactivation, yeah, we'll have a smaller calcium release. Yeah. Smaller calcium release will produce a smaller calcium depletion. A smaller calcium depletion will produce a smaller calcium transient. Smaller calcium transient will produce a smaller activation of the sodium calcium exchanger. Yeah, and we will get a shorter action potential. The second hypothesis, yeah, is linked to an insufficient calcium reuptake by the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Yeah, we have the same scheme. If we increase the heart rate, yeah, you can see that the diastolic calcium level inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum cannot go up to the original diastolic calcium level. Yeah, if we have less calcium, we'll have less calcium release. We'll have smaller calcium transients. We'll have a smaller activation of the sodium calcium exchanger, and we'll have a shorter action potential. So these are these two competitive hypotheses. Yeah, there are evidence for both, and my talk will be centered on this. Yeah, there are some people that shows that you can have calcium alternances in the absence of diastolic alternances inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And there are some people like us, yeah, that we found that when you have alternances in the cytosol, these are correlated with alternances in the diastolic level of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So our hypothesis is that the temperature dependency of alternance strongly depends on the high enthalpy of the sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium reuptake. So in order to study this phenomenon, we develop a technique that we call FLOM, fluorescent local field optical mapping. The idea is the following. We developed this apparatus, yeah? We have a fast camera that can take 2,500 frames per second, yeah? We have an optical conduit that will be in contact with the tissue. We have an optical fiber that brings the laser beam inside this apparatus. Yeah, and what we will do is we'll touch the epicardium, and we can also do it in the endocardium of a mouse heart or any other mammalian, yeah? So it's a contact fluorescent microscopy, yeah? It's an epifluorescent arrangement, yeah? We excite and we detect through the same lens and optical conduct, yeah? If we look at the optical conduct, the optical conduct is a pack of multiple fiber optics, yeah? Each fiber optic can go from 10 to 3 microns. So our resolution is 3 microns, so 2.8 microns, yeah? So we can have subcellular imaging, yeah, using this optical conduit touching the ventricular wall. So this is an arrangement of the apparatus. Yeah, we can mount this microscope on a micro manipulator. Yeah, the resolution of the system depends on the properties of the optical conduit. Yeah, optical conduit have different size, different numerical apertures, and different optical resolutions. Yeah, here you can see 2 microns. This is a bar code. Yeah, 600 microns. Yeah, and this you can see this little hair on the 200 microns. Yeah, the actual spatial resolution. Yeah, is defined by a Bessel function. So here you can see that. The detection sensitivity of the technique when we touch the epicardium is 12.3 microns, yeah? And this is a typical image, yeah, of the epicardial layer. Yeah, you can see the vessels, and when you move, you can see the structure, yeah? So Flom can resolve different structures, yeah? The optical resolution of Flom depends on the properties of the optical conduct. So this we can use it to measure calcium and action potentials. Yeah, these are an image of calcium. Yeah, if we produce a line scan, this is space and this is time. Yeah, you can see calcium transients. Yeah, these are sequences of the images. Yeah, these are typical calcium transients recorded with Flom. This is the average calcium transient in this area, and these are action potentials recorded with Flom. Yeah. Using the potentiometric dye, the 8 and X, yeah? So Flom can evaluate the kinetics of calcium transients and action potential. Moreover, yeah, Flom can also look at the distribution of action potentials and calcium transients. So you can see, yeah, this is the tip of the Flom, and you can see all these action potentials in different positions. So we can have a map of the action potential distribution, and this is the statistics of all the action potentials, yeah? So Flom reports the temporal and spatial action potential kinetics. So although Flom can record in the epicardium and endocardium, yeah, we need to have a way of seeing how the signaling was distributed across the ventricular wall. So for this, we develop what we call transmural fluorescent local field optical mapping, TFLOM. Yeah, the idea is the following. We have an optical conduit, and we can shape the optical conduit with some paper. Yeah, and you can see that they have the shape of a needle. Yeah, this on the tip. The tip of the optical conduit will see the endocardium, and the back of the optical conduit will see the endocardium, the epicardium. And see, it's a magnified region, yeah. So I thought I think it's a bad idea to use this thing because I cannot. So this is transmural optical conduit. Yeah, I will do it again. Getting in the drop of fluorescence, you can see that how the if we get in the drop, yeah, we have more fluorescence. So we decide to evaluate this. This is the back of the optical conduit, these 200 microns, yeah, and these are the images. Yeah, we can obtain. Yeah, and if we analyze the images, this will be close to the epicardium, this is close to the endocardium. So we can get recordings, and you can see that the endocardial layer, yeah, depolarized between the before the epicardial layer, and that we have more alternances in the endocardium than in the epicardium. And there is a transmural distribution of alternances. So calcium alternances are transmurally distributed across the ventricular wall. Yeah, there are more alternances in the endocardium than the epicardium, yeah? And as we get closer to the epicardium, we have less alternances. So one way to evaluate the change in enthalpy of the calcium uptake is by locally changing the temperature of the tissue. So we develop another technique, yeah, where we have an optical conduit. Yeah, inside this structure. Here we have what we call a cold finger. This cold finger will be able to locally produce a change in temperature, will cool the tissue, and will have a temperature gradient between this point and this point. Yeah, this is an optical quantity. This is a cold finger, and this is maintained to a constant temperature. Yeah, using a Peltier unit and a radiator. Yeah, so we measure the distribution of the action potential. So we can see that in the warmer regions, the calcium transients are faster than the colder regions. So local temperature increments the speed of relaxation of calcium transients. How we can compute a calcium distribution maps? Yeah, so what we did was to use the Flom technique and to increase the heart rate. Here you can see a big calcium transient, small, big, small. Yeah, so we'll compute the alternances as the large amplitude minus the small amplitude divided by the large amplitude. Yeah, this is a map of the large amplitude. This is a map of the small amplitude. And if we compute these, yeah, we'll get a map of the alternances. Yeah, the places where it's more red, there are more alternances than the places there is green. Yeah, this is a map of the alternances. So you can see that this place, yeah, that is warmer, yeah, they have small alternances, and this place that is cooler, yeah, they have more alternances, and the red color indicates high alternances. Yeah, so cold regions display higher calcium alternance. So it must be a metabolic process involving this, and this is what lead us to think that the reuptake of calcium the calcium to the sarcoplasmic reticulum was involved in the generation of alternances. So what happened at different heart rates? So we have our cold finger and Flom apparatus. Yeah. This is at 4 hertz. Yeah, there are no alternances. You can see that the relaxations are slower in the cold region. Yeah, 5 hertz, we start seeing little alternances. Yeah, 6 hertz, we have big alternances in the cold region, and basically no alternances in the warm region. 7 hertz, we have big alternances in the cold region. Yeah, and small in the warm region. And at 8 hertz, we have huge alternances in the cold region and very mild alternances in the warm region. Yeah. So this indicates that cooler regions alternate before than warmer ones. So there must be some metabolic process involved in the generation of these alternances. So if we look at the amplitude of the alternances, yeah, between the warm region and the cold region, we can see that the amplitude in the cold region is much larger than the amplitude in the warm region. So I show you that there is a relationship between intracellular calcium release and electrical events. Yeah, here what we did was a line scan. Yeah. Yeah, these are big alternances, these are small alternances. You can see that here we have very mild alternances and here we have big alternances. Yeah, this is measuring calcium, yeah, in the cytosol. And if we measure action potentials in the cytosol, yeah, and we look at the action potentials are not very different, and we'll spend some time on that. Yeah, so if we locally cool the tissue, we cannot find big differences in the duration of the action potential. Although, if we globally cool the tissue, you can see that globally cooling the tissue has a big impact, yeah, on the duration of the action potential. This is anti-intuitive, yeah, because at lower temperatures, the action potentials are shorter than at larger temperatures. And this because the sodium calcium exchanger, they have a huge temperature dependency, like 3.6, 3.7, yeah, Q10. So it's more difficult to activate the sodium calcium exchanger at lower temperatures. Yeah. So another question we have is, how cold is cold? Yeah, here I'm telling you that I'm cooling, but we don't know how cold is cold. Yeah. So calcium alternances are not always generated by electrical alternances. You can see that we have big calcium alternances with no electrical alternances. So let's see what happened with the action potential if we locally cool the tissue, yeah? So these are alternances at high temperature and low temperature. These are local changes, yeah? These are distribution at different heart rates, and you can see that there is no difference between the duration of the action potentials at any heart rate, yeah? But if we globally cool the tissue, yeah, you can see that we have a long action potential, a short action potential. And if we superimpose both action potentials, you can see a long and a short. Yeah. And this is if we change globally the temperature of the tissue. Yeah. So global temperature change and not local ones induce action potential alternances. If we cool massively the tissue, we'll have alternances. If we cool it locally, will not have it. Yeah, and I would like to come to this issue again. Yeah, and this is basically because when we are locally cooling, yeah, the ventricular wall, they have an electrotone. Yeah, so the rest of the tissue is imposing this electrotone on the area that is locally cool. Yeah, so the action potential will not change. So which are the global temperature effect on the calcium transient? So these are 32, 30, 28, 26, 24, 22, 20. Yeah, you can see that as we increase the temperature, the peak of the calcium transients appears sooner. Yeah, and the duration of the action of the calcium transient is shorter in comparison with recordings at low temperature. Yeah. So global temperature can heavily modify the calcium transients, yeah? So if we take the data from this set of images, yeah, we can find these 32, and this is 20, 32 is here, yeah? If we cool the tissue, yeah, the calcium transients will get shorter. So we are interested in looking at the velocity of relaxation. One way of looking at the velocity of relaxation is by computing the first derivative of the relaxation process. So if we do that, we can see that in the warmer region, the first derivative is larger than the colder regions, yeah? So the first derivative of the calcium bound to the dye, they can give us a velocity. So if we have a velocity, what we can compute is an Arrhenius plot, where we have the logarithm of the velocity as function of 1 over the temperature, yeah? So you can see that there is a single thermodynamic process, yeah? Yeah, and if we fit an Arrhenius plot, yeah, we will be able to calculate the change in enthalpy that will be 9.17 kilocalories per mole, and a change in entropy that it will be 34.7 calorie per mole Kelvin. Mm? So if we plot the velocity as function of the temperature, not the logarithm of the velocity as function of 1 over the temperature, we'll find this curve, yeah, that they have an exponential behavior that makes sense because here we have a logarithm. But you also can see that we can simplify the problem by fitting a line, because fitting a line, you will see that we have all the points. The line is touching all the points, yeah? So the Arrhenius plot shows that the calcium transient relaxation is governed by a unique thermodynamic process. We have only one process here, yeah? And this is basically Arrhen, no? Arrhen applied to an Arrhenius plot. So here we have a relationship between the velocity and the temperature. So perhaps we can use the velocity of the relaxation of the transient to evaluate the local temperature. So this is a sequence of events, yeah, at different times, t plus 1, t plus 2, t plus n. Yeah, we can compute the first derivative by making the subtraction between t minus t1 divided by delta t. IT1 minus IT2 divided by delta T. So this is a map of the first derivatives. Yeah, this is a map of the transients. This is a map of the first derivatives. This is a map of the first derivative. So we can calculate the maximum derivative, that is this, yeah? And knowing the maximum derivative, yeah, we know that the minus the maximum derivative, they will be the equation of a line, as I show you, this not a big difference, A plus BT, yeah? So then we can compute T from the first derivative, A and B, yeah, that we obtained from the previous plot, yeah? And this gives us a temperature profile, yeah? So by measuring the derivatives, we can locally see how the temperature is changing in the tissue, yeah? So the cold finger imposed, if you look here we have 22 and 27, the cold finger imposed a temperature gradient of 5 Celsius. Local cooling induced calcium alternances at different heart rates. Yeah, what we did was to plot the alternances as function of the local temperature. Yeah, so this is a point. Yeah, this is this point. If we compute all the temperature points and all the alternance points, yeah, we have this plot. Yeah, that the higher temperatures, we have lower alternances. Yeah, this heavily depends on the heart rate. Yeah. These are 7 hertz, 6 hertz, and 5 hertz. You can see that an increase in the heart rate increases the chances of developing alternances, yeah? At high heart rates, the temperature dependency of alternances is amplified, yeah? Calcium have a high temperature dependency, yeah? The calcium alternances, they have a temperature dependency around Q10, around 3, yeah? So what we did was to compute the Q10, yeah, at different heart rates, yeah. This is 1.6, yeah, this is 2.1, and this is 3.2, yeah. You can see that the temperature dependency also depends on the heart rate, yeah, a Q10 of 3.3, yeah. So we wanted to correlate this temperature dependency with the temperature dependency of SARCA2. So for this, what we did, we got microsomes, yeah? We got a low affinity dye outside the microsomes. We add calcium and ATP, and we look at the time the calcium relax. These are different temperatures, yeah? 9 to 37. So we can compute the first derivatives, yeah? And look at the velocities. So when we look at the velocities, the logarithm of the rate as function of one of the temperature, we found that the change in enthalpy is much larger than the change in enthalpy of the relaxation of the transients. Yeah, we found that the change in enthalpy of the relaxation of the transient was around 9.2, and here is 20.4. So the pump has a much larger temperature dependency. The energy barrier is much larger, yeah, than what we see in the calcium transients. This somehow indicates that the pump is not the only mechanism involving the relaxation of the transient. Yeah, if we plot the heart rate as function of the temperature, we will have this exponential distribution, yeah? And this have a Q10 of 3.2. So you can see that this Q10, the Q10 of the pump, is very similar to the Q10 of the alternances, yeah? So the SAR calcium refilling mediated by SARCA has a temperature dependency similar to the calcium alternances. So somehow it's indicating that the pump is important, but we need to have more conclusive evidence. Yeah? So there is any evidence that luminal calcium regulates calcium alternances? Yeah? So let's look at this problem. Yeah? So one way to increase the luminal calcium concentration is by blocking the sodium calcium exchanger. We have several ways to block. The sodium calcium exchanger can extrude, can produce the influx of sodium, but not the influx of lithium. So if we change half of the sodium by lithium, we'll see an increase in the calcium concentration. Here we are measuring calcium concentration inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum using a low affinity dye, yeah, and pacing at a low heart rate, yeah. So if we block the exchanger, we have an increase in the diastolic and also in the systolic depletion during a calcium transient. When we look at the alternances, yeah, under the control situation, we have no alternances. And if we increase calcium concentration inside the SAR, we have big alternances. Yeah. And these are the amplitude of the alternances at different concentrations of lithium. Yeah. 0, 35, 70 and 105 millimolar. Here we have a little bit of the depolarization and less calcium influx. An increase in the free calcium inside the SR can induce calcium alternances. So why? Why this is happening? Yeah, why an increase in calcium inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum can produce alternances? Yeah. As I told you at the beginning, the RION receptor is regulated by this protein, calsequestrin. Calsequestrin binds to the RION receptor through two accessory proteins, triadin and xanthin. Yeah. So if calsequestrin is attached to these proteins, yeah, the RION receptor shows is partially inhibited, yeah, shows a low open probability. But if calcium goes up inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum, calcium will bind to calsequestrin, they will produce a conformational change, and this will deattach from triadin and xanthin and will dramatically increase the open probability of the RION receptor. So the RION receptor is an schizophrenic channel. They have like two personalities. Sometimes they open very short, yeah, and it's closed for long times, and sometimes they open very long and it's closed for short times. Yeah. So calsequestrin modify these two modal gatings that appear in the RION receptor. So this is a control situation, yeah, having calsequestrin. Yeah, you can see big alternances. So what we decide was to knock out calsequestrin, yeah, and if we knock out calsequestrin, this is a collaboration with Bjorn Nolman at Vanderbilt University, yeah, you can see that if we knock out calsequestrin, yeah, we basically abolish alternances. So calcium inside the SAR can produce alternances because if we have high calcium, yeah, the channel is very active, but when calcium is depleted, the open probability of the channel decreases. So the gain of this mechanism that is called calcium-induced calcium release decrease and is producing alternances. And this is how the alternances depends on the cardiac cycle, and this is how the alternances depends on the heart rate. So calsequestrin, luminal regulation is involved in the genesis of calcium alternances. Yeah. So calcium inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum is very important in defining alternances. Is there any other way to increase the calcium uptake? Yeah. So as I told you at the beginning, SERCA2 is modulated by this other protein. It's called phospholamban. Phospholamban can be phosphorylated in two sites. Yeah. These are typical calcium transients. Yeah. It can be regulated in acetylin 16 by protein kinase A, yeah, and it's regulated in threonine 17 by CAM kinase 2, yeah. If we have a beta adrenergic stimulation, a sympathetic drive, yeah, these both things will appear because we will have a larger increase of the catalytic subunit dissociated from PKA. And also an increase in free calcium concentration that will promote an activation of CAM kinase 2. Yeah. So what we did was to mutate, yeah, these two residues by alanines, yeah, an alanine and an alanine. So if phospholamban is not phosphorylating, will be attached all the time to the SERCA pump and will be inhibiting the pump. And you can see that the relaxation rate is lower. Yeah. So phospholamban regulates the relaxation of calcium transients. So which is the effect of phosphorylating phospholamban on alternances? Yeah. So here we have calcium. You can see, yeah, that endocardial calcium alternates more than the epicardial calcium. If we look at the action potential, also endocardial, yeah, alternates, and epicardial don't alternate. And if we look at the AKG, we have a big T wave, no T wave, big T wave, no T wave. Yeah. So clearly, under a control situation, yeah, we have big alternances in calcium, in the action potential, and in the electrocardiogram. If we perfuse the heart with 300 nanomolar of isoproterenol, yeah, to induce the activation of beta 1 adrenergic receptors, yeah, we'll see that the amplitude of the alternances is much smaller, yeah? That the alternances in the epicardium basically disappear, and there's a big reduction in the alternances in the endocardium. The, the alternances in the duration of the action potential basically disappear, and we have no alternances in the electrocardiogram. So this indicates that sympathetic stimulation prevents the genesis of alternances. So if we can phosphorylate phospholamban, this will prevent the genesis of alternances. The problem here is that when we have a beta renergic stimulation, we have several other processes. We have a phosphorylation of the L-type calcium channel, so we have more calcium coming in the cells. We have a phosphorylation of the RAN receptor. There are two sites, acerin 2809 and acerin 2814, that can be phosphorylated, so it's much more complex. So we wanted to have a direct way to show that changing the velocity of the pump was critical in defining alternances. So what we did was to have a control experiment. This is a 33 Celsius. You can see alternances that are very small. And if we partially block the pump with 200 nanomolar of tapsigargin, tapsigargin is a blocker of the pump. You can see big alternances. And if you wait 8 minutes, you can see that you have a depletion in calcium inside the SAR. And perhaps I can go through this at the end of my talk. Less calcium inside the SAR. As I show you for the sodium calcium exchanger, will produce less alternances. If we compare a partially blocking SARCA with tapsigargin, increase alternances. So if the transport rate of the pump is lower, we have more alternances. And this is the data. This is the alternances, A max minus A min divided by A max. So you can see that there is a significant increase in the amplitude of the alternances. When the heart, is perfused with tapsigargin to partially block the SARCA pump. So the last question we have is why some authors, as I indicated at the beginning, can see calcium alternances without changes in the luminal diastolic calcium. In order to address this point, we use another technique we developed in the lab. It's called loose patch photolysis, and it's a technique to evaluate calcium currents both in epicardium and endocardium and in intact beating heart. Here we have a patch amplifier to record the current. Here we have a microelectrode to record action potential. Here we have a current to voltage converter to clamp the potential of the bath at the same potential of the pipette. So we have the bath and the pipette at the same potential. And here we have an optical fiber to locally measure action potentials. So here we can see calcium transients, and locally measure action potentials. Both are optical recordings. And this is an electrical recording. So in principle, this amplifier, this current to voltage converter, can report the ionic current. And this technique is called loose patch photolysis. And we published it in Circulation Research. How we can separate the currents? So the idea is the following. So what we do is we perfuse the heart with nifedipine. The nifedipine, they have this aromatic group. So if we look at the absorption of nifedipine, they have a big absorption in 350. So what we did was to use a laser that is called DPSS that produce pulses of 355 nanometers, and 50 nanoseconds, and we'll use this laser to kill nifedipine. So we'll perfuse the heart with nifedipine, and then we'll photolyze nifedipine. So at the beginning, we'll have more small calcium currents, and at the end, we'll have large calcium currents. This is the control situation with nifedipine. You can see that the repolarization with nifedipine is faster. This basically we have because we have less calcium release from the SAR and we can activate less the sodium calcium exchanger. And if we photolyze, you can see that there is no a big effect on the action potentials, as we show when we report the local changes in temperature on the action potentials. And if we measure the difference between both, the action potentials cancel completely. And here you can see a current. The current have two components, a fast component that is mediated by an influx of calcium through L-type calcium channel. I don't have time to go on detail on this, yeah, but I already give a talk in the Institute about this. And a slow component that is an influx of sodium through the sodium calcium exchanger. So the nifedipine photolysis activate an inward current. Interestingly, action potentials does not change because the electrotone induced by the tissue. This is the same issue. Yeah, although we are able to locally increase a current, yeah, the electrotone of the tissue will maintain, yeah, the duration and the kinetics of the action potential. Epicardial calcium alternates, why they can happen without luminal diastolic calcium changes, yeah? Let's look at the heart, yeah? We have epicardium and endocardium, yeah? If we measure calcium in endocardium, we can see big alternances, and you can see big alternances in the endocardial layer, yeah? But these cells are electrically coupled. These cells are coupled through connexin 43, yeah? So it is possible to expect that we will have some effect of the shortening of the action potential in the epicardial layer. The thickness of the ventricular wall in the mouse is very small. It can be 2 millimeters. And here you can see that, again, yeah, that when this happens, we have a long action potential, and here we have a shorter action potential, yeah? So I didn't have time to explain, and this we did with Emiliano Medei. Yeah, we found that the repolarization of phase one of the action potential was critically defined the influx of calcium to the cell, yeah? So little changes in the phase one can produce big changes in the calcium currents, yeah? So action potential alternances can propagate transmurally, yeah? So what happened with the calcium currents, yeah? Let's look at the calcium currents. This is a normal action potential. We have a big influx of calcium, and we have the activation of the sodium calcium exchanger, yeah? But in the next pulse, yeah, as the action potential repolarizes faster, we have less calcium coming in the cell, and we'll have less calcium release and lower more alternances. So you can see big alternances, no alternances, yeah? So the L-type calcium current alternance can be generated by calcium alternance in the epicardium, yeah? Although here we're not changing the calcium content in the SR, yeah? The propagation of the electrical stimulus from the endocardium to the epicardium will produce epicardial shortening of the action potential, will have less calcium coming into the cell, and this can produce alternances. So to conclude, yeah, local temperature changes dramatically change the distribution of alternances. This we show it with the cold finger, yeah. Temperature dependency of calcium transient relaxation has a temperature dependency lower than the active transport mediated by CERCA, yeah. We found that was 9.2 against 20.4, yeah? And usually the main mechanism implying the relaxation of the transient is CERCA, but we need to remember that we have both active and passive mechanisms, yeah? Active mechanisms are related to the primary and secondary active transport, yeah, mediated by CERCA and the sodium calcium exchanger, but inside the cell, we have a lot of buffers, yeah? Calmodulin, ATP can bind calcium, yeah? Troponin C. So this buffer, this passive buffering capacity can be very important in the relaxation of a calcium transient in the mouse where the heart rate is very high, yeah? This suggests that the calcium buffering, yeah, passive calcium buffering plays a central role in the relaxation of calcium transients. The thermodynamics of calcium alternance is more compatible with the hypothesis that calcium alternances are produced by an incomplete refilling of the sarcoplasmic reticulum during tachycardia and not by an intriguing properties of the Ryan receptor. We show several evidence. Locally cooling increases alternances, yeah. The luminal regulation through calsequestrin. If we don't have calsequestrin, we don't have calcium alternances, and the calsequestrin is inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And we also show that increasing the rate of the pump, yeah, will prevent alternances, and decreases the rate of the pump will induce alternances, yeah. So calcium alternances can be modified by circuit transport velocity and calcium sequestration, yeah. Calcium alternances in the pericardium in the absence of calcium alternates inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum can be produced by alternates in the L-type calcium current. And finally, we think that this experimental approach can help us understand how spatial distribution of a metabolic impairment can induce cardiac arrhythmias. The collaborators, yeah, with Josefina Ramos Franco from Rush University in Chicago, we developed the loose patch photolysis. Julio Copello did the experiments on the microsomes, looking at the uptake of calcium at different temperatures. I didn't have time to show data from Emiliano, but with Emiliano, we found that the rate of repolarization during phase one is critical in defining the amount of calcium getting inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And PEP, the students were students and postdocs that were involved, Juliana Aguilar Sanchez, did a lot of the experiments. Dimitri Gornayev did all the experiments showing the intracellular calcium transients. Maeda Basmi did all the experiments looking at the effect of taxigargin on the amplitude of the calcium alternances, and Diego Feinstein was involved in developing some of the software we implemented for measuring the spatial distribution of calcium and action potentials using the FLOM technique. And finally, Pep Millet, he is the vice chancellor of the University of Universidad Politécnica de Valencia. He spent a sabbatical year in my lab, and he was very interested in this problem, how local cooling can induce arrhythmias in a beating heart. So thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you very much, Ariel, for your exciting presentation. We can start with the questions from the chat. We can read two questions from Luis Bonanno. The first one.
Wait a second. I will turn on my camera.
Yes.
So you can look at my face.
Dr. Ariel, you can also stop the presentation, because then you can see you.
I try to. Yeah.
Can you
see stop presentation? Okay.
Yes. Perfect. Thank you.
I will have to show again the presentation for answering questions. Yeah.
Okay.
Luis, how are you?
Ariel, you can read the chat?
No, read for me would be great.
I will read the first question from Luis Gonal. Ariel, do you think that it's possible that cells at the endocardium exert a negative FFR, fraction flow reserve, while cells at epicardium exert a positive FFR due to the differences in CERCA expression?
Yeah, we think so. We know that calcium transients are slower in the endocardium. There is much less CERCA pump in the endocardium, not only at the messenger level, but also at the protein level. And the other issue is that phospholamban expression does not change. So the fraction of pumps blocked by phospholamban in the endocardium is much larger than in the epicardium. So the endocardium is much more sensitive to develop alternances than the epicardium. So sometimes we have this idea that the ventricular cells are identical. Ventricular cells are very different, yeah? There is difference between the endocardium, the mid-myocardium, and the epicardium, yeah? Neuroscientists, they found this long time ago, but the people in the cardiac field, they refuse sometimes to accept this issue, that the cells are functionally and molecularly different between the endocardium and the epicardium.
Well, thanks for your answer, Ariel. Oh, Luis, could you please write some reply or some comment? Well, I will read the second question by Luis. Ariel, yeah. It looks that lithium makes SR calcium replenishment slower. Is that the case? Does it relate with the occurrence of alternances when you add lithium?
Well, the lithium, what will do, will partially block, yeah, the sodium calcium exchanger, and they will increase the intracellular calcium content. But to answer that question, I would like to show another experiment I decided not to show. Let me see if I can do this. Let me see. Present now a window. Okay. Okay. Let me show. So what we see using lithium, we can also see it if we change extracellular calcium concentration. Yeah. Here we have 2 millimolar calcium outside the cell. You can see alternances. And if we reduce from 2 millimolar to 0.5 millimolar, yeah, alternances disappear. And I will try to show that changes in extracellular calcium will change the intracellular calcium, the sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium content. So you can see a big decrease in the amplitude of the alternances. So if we increase calcium concentration from 2 millimolar to 5 millimolar, you can see that it's a dramatic increase in the amplitude of the alternances. Yeah. 2 millimolar, 5 millimolar. Yeah. So we wanted to understand why when we increase calcium. So in order to do that, what we did was to measure calcium inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Yeah. This is 2 millimolar, this is 5 millimolar. You can see that there is an increase in the diastolic calcium level inside the SAR. There is an increase in the amplitude of the SR calcium release. Yeah. And these are the numbers for the diastolic fluorescence and for the amplitude in the intracellular calcium release. So anything we do, yeah, or to increase the influx of calcium or to decrease the efflux of calcium across the plasma membrane will heavily modify the intracellular calcium content. And this is a central mechanism, yeah. It's very difficult to modify the dynamics in long term acting on some proteins in the sarcoplasmic reticulum. If we really want to change the free calcium concentration in the SAR, we need to change the fluxes across the plasma membrane, yeah, or increasing the influx, yeah, through the L-type calcium channel, or decreasing the influx through the L-type calcium channels, or inhibiting the secondary active transport through the sodium calcium exchanger.
Thank you. Emiliano, do you have a question?
I think Professor Antonio Carlos.
Yes, Adalberto, thank you so much. And Ariel, thank you so much for a beautiful presentation. And also I'd like to thank you for help us always with our setup and to training our students for the postgraduate program of physiology. And Ariel, what happened with the extracellular calcium? What is the role that play the extracellular calcium in the alternance mechanisms?
Well, this is what I just show. I don't know if you can you see. Can you see my slide?
No.
And now, can you see it?
No.
Okay. Let's go back to here. I'm cancel. Present now a window Can you see? Yeah, so if you decrease the cellular calcium, delta masses decreases, yeah, because you have less calcium getting in the cell, yeah, so you have less SR calcium load. And if you increase extracellular calcium, yeah, you will increase alternances. And this is basically because you are loading more the SAR. If you load more the SAR, you have more calcium release. So you can go from a high gain of calcium-induced calcium release because calsequestrin is detached from the ion receptor. And when you deplete, yeah, you will go to a low gain in intracellular calcium release. So this high gain, low gain is central in the developing of the alternances.
Thank you. Antonio, do you have a question?
Yes, I actually have two questions for Ariel. The first one is, if I understood correctly, your cold finger would apply a temperature gradient mainly in the epicardial part of the heart.
Yes.
And I wonder if you also measured a gradient, a transmural gradient. And because if I remember correctly, the epicardial was more sensitive to the alternates, if I can remember correctly. And the second question, which I think is
please can you mute the phone, the microphone?
Pardon me?
No. I think was a child talking.
It was. And the second question for you is, since this whole phenomena seems to be so dependent on beat rate, and it expresses itself at beat rates that are hardly or impossible to achieve in human cells, have you had the chance to examine if the same thing would happen in cardiomyocytes derived from human cells the same way, and what would be the frequency dependence in human hearts?
Yeah, I never tried in human ones because I don't have access to a whole human heart. Yeah, but I did some experiments in dogs and in cats. Yeah. And the dog electrophysiology is very similar to the human one, yeah? And this happened at lower heart rates in cats and dogs. The mice, as you state, yes, there is an animal that works at a very high heart rate. But if you do it in an animal that have a heart rate more compatible with a human, yeah, the alternances appear at lower frequencies, and this happen usually. Let's suppose we have a local ischemia, yeah, a local ischemia will produce a metabolic impairment of the production of ATP, yeah. So in the place we have a local ischemia, we can have alternances. So usually alternances, they don't appear in a normal heart. Because the pump is able to maintain the transport to the SAR. But if you have a local metabolic impairment in some area of the ventricle, like a local ischemia, yeah. Or like when you wake up, sometimes you wake up in the REM sleep, and when you are in REM, you cannot control the very well the temperature of the body. Yeah, so in those situations, it's more likely to see alternances. If you have a decrease in the body temperature, or you have a metabolic impairment because you have an ischemia. Yeah. Other conditions in which you have can have alternances if you have a tachycardia, no? Let's suppose you have a supraventricular tachycardia. This will increase the heart rate, so the chances of developing alternances are also higher. But in under physiological conditions, yeah, is not easy to see alternances. You need to have some pathophysiological effect, yeah, to see alternances.
Thank you.
Ariel, I have one comment from our president, Dr. Isis Hada Trevensoli. I will read it. On behalf of the Cell Physiology and Biophysics Program, we thank you very much for this excellent presentation, Dr. Escobar. I have two questions. May I ask?
Yeah.
The first one, which are the molecular mechanisms of the high enthalpy of calcium uptake? And the second, I think that is a speculation, are they related with the changes of the phosphorylated intermediate, the energy changes of the phosphorylated intermediate of CERCA during the catalytic cycle?
Okay, that's a very good question. The iris of ITP produce 7.3 kilocalories per mole. So hydrolyzing ATP will give a high enthalpy. The high enthalpy of CERCA heavily depends on the hydrolysis of ATP. Yeah. The high enthalpy of in the sodium calcium exchanger, yeah, has to be mostly with structural features of the sodium calcium exchanger. For a long time, when we were thinking about temperature dependency of a membrane protein, we were able to separate this in two sides. One, like ionic channels that have a low temperature dependency because they don't hydrolyze ATP, and active transport systems, primary active transport systems that they need to hydrolyze ATP, and this gives a big temperature dependency. Now we know that that's not always the case. There are some proteins temperature sensors sensitive to menthol and capsaicin, yeah, transient potential receptor, yeah, that although they don't hydrolyze ATP, they have a big temperature dependency because they have huge conformational changes. So I think the high enthalpy of the calcium uptake is related to the hydrolysis of ATP, and related to the phosphorylation, yeah. I think yes, yeah, the phosphorylation will have a big temperature dependency. So there was one thing that was worrying us a lot, yeah. And is that we are measuring calcium signaling with a calcium indicator, yeah? So we wanted to be sure that the calcium indicator kinetics was not involved in showing the effects on the relaxation of the calcium transients. So if I can show, I have two figures, yeah? So what we did was to evaluate the temperature dependency on the dye. This is something we developed a long time ago, yeah? This is DNitrophen that is like EDTA, DNitrophen-free, DNitrophen bound to calcium and calcium, yeah? If we illuminate with a UV flash, yeah, we'll break some DNitrophen molecules, yeah? So we'll increase the free calcium, yeah? There's an increase in free calcium.
Ariel, ¿lo estás compartiendo a tela, por favor? Share your screen.
Okay. Let me see. Cancel. Present now. Window. Can you see now?
No.
No?
No.
I'm sharing the screen. Cancel. Present. Window. Share. Can you see now?
Yes. We can see. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So the idea is the following. Yeah, we have this dimethyltryptophan. Yeah, that is like EDTA. That is photosensitive. Yeah, we can illuminate it and produce a change in free calcium. So when we photolyze, we have an increase in calcium. And then we have all these molecules of dimethyltryptophan that they are free, so they will rebound calcium. So we can produce a calcium spike, and a calcium spike that is very fast, 50 microseconds. So we use this to evaluate the kinetics of the dyes at different temperatures. Yeah, this is a typical experiment. At 21 and 37, you can see that the 37 relax much faster. Yeah. The calcium bound to the dye will be proportional to K-on times the total dye concentration times the exponential of minus K-off times T times the integral of this spike, yeah, where K-off is 1 over tau, and K-on is K-off over K-B, yeah? So the dimethyltryptophan can generate the spike. The first thing we decided was to look at the steady-state behavior of the dye. Yeah, different temperature, you can see that an increase in temperature increase the affinity of the dye. This means that the temperature dependency or the change in enthalpy of K-on and K-off are different. So we decided to look at different temperatures from 17 to 37. You can see that at 37 they are faster. Yeah. We can calculate the Arrhenius plot for K-off, yeah, and this gives us the change in enthalpy that is smaller, yeah, is 4.2 kilocalories per mole. When we look at the Arrhenius plot of K-on, yeah, this will be like 11.1 kilocalories per mole, yeah. So the temperature dependency of K-on is larger than the temperature dependency of K-off, and this makes sense, because the energy barrier you need to jump, yeah, your bind calcium is larger than to unbind, yeah. These calcium indicators, when they don't have calcium bound, they have some protons bound or some potassium bound to the site. And if we look at the temperature dependency of K-off, yeah, you can see that the temperature dependency of K-off is very fast, yeah. It's around 300 hertz. Yeah, K-on is around 20 hertz, and if we look at the temperature dependency of the relaxation of the transient, is much lower. So although, yeah, the dye has an important temperature dependency, the rate of reactions, yeah, K-on and K-off, are much faster than what we see during the relaxation of the transient. So we don't think that the calcium indicator is involved in defining the relaxation process.
Well, thank you very much. You really clarified this question for me. Well, are there more questions? Well, Ariel, thank you very much. I hope to meet you here in 2021.
Soon.
In December 2029.
Well, no.
21.
If you have the shots before, I can go earlier. Well, okay. Thanks a lot for the meeting.
A vaccine. We can be here with a vaccine.
Yeah. No. I will be there with a vaccine. Not. I was planning going to Uruguay and Argentina in December, but I refused. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much again. Well, I would like to see all the microphones open to say again, thank you very much, Ariel.
Oh my God. Okay, thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye bye. Professor Adalberto, muito obrigado pela mediação da conferência. Vou interromper agora a gravação e então declaro encerrada a conferência de hoje. Muito obrigado a todos e a todas e até a semana que vem.
Até a semana que vem. Grande abraço.
Grande abraço.